It's a very important topic in obstetric point of view, because if you see the incidence of the PIH, premature hypertension, if you see the incidence of the pregnancy induced hypertension according to WHO, it contributes around 16% of the all maternal mortality, and the incidence is 5 to 10%. So it's a commonest cause for maternal mortality. Second cause is of course 13% of abortion. 8%, so 13% they are PPH, postpartum hemorrhage. 8% are abortion. 2% are sepsis. So it's very important to learn this condition, which complicates 5 to 10% of all pregnancies. The incidence is higher in primary gravida and lower and in lower socioeconomic group. How we classify the hypertension during pregnancy? The first is gestational hypertension, then preeclampsia, then chronic hypertension complicating the pregnancy, or it may be essential or secondary hypertension. And last is a preeclampsia superimposed with chronic hypertension. So what is meant by gestational hypertension? Gestational hypertension is a rise of blood pressure during pregnancy, usually after 20 weeks of gestation, which was never noted before pregnancy, and usually it subsides or resides within 3 months postpartum. So that is called as gestational hypertension. Then what is preeclampsia? Preeclampsia is a multisystem disorder which is characterized by rise in blood pressure and with proteinuria, or along with the involvement of the other organ system, one or more organ system of the mother. The IUGR, or involvement of the, here it is, written the organ system of fetus, but IUGR, ACOG, this thing, they have not included IUGR in preeclampsia definition. In chronic hypertension, the hypertension is confirmed preconceptional or prior 20 weeks of gestation without any known cause, and it involves some of the patient is already on antihypertensive treatment, and there is rise of blood pressure during pregnancy or continuation of rise of blood pressure during pregnancy. It is chronic hypertension occurring during pregnancy. So then it may be essential, which is rare because the patients are young, usually pregnant patient, they are young. But it may be a secondary type of hypertension because of chronic liver kidney disease, like glomerular nephritis or nephropathy, or adult polycystic kidney disease. Sometimes there is a renal artery stenosis. Sometimes there is a systemic disease like systemic liver erythematosus, then diabetes mellitus. Sometimes there are other endocrine disorders like pheochromocytoma, hyperthyroidism, coarctation of aorta, and sometimes patient is already on medication. And the preeclampsia, which is superimposed with the chronic hypertension or aggravated by the pregnancy. All these are the classifications of hypertension during pregnancy. So in brief, you will see the definitions. Gestational hypertension, more than blood pressure more than 140/90, observe at least 2 occasions 6 hours apart after 20 weeks of gestation with previous normal blood pressure. This is without proteinuria. And preeclampsia is a gestational hypertension which has a proteinuria of more than 300 milligram per 24 hours. The protein to creatinine ratio is more than 0.3. Or with dipstick, if you see the urine protein, it will be 1 plus. So either the hypertension with proteinuria or other signs of organ involvement, like there may be a low platelet count, thrombocytopenia less than 1 lakh. Then renal insufficiency, the creatinine is more than 1.1, or sometimes there is a doubling of the baseline. Then there will be an abnormal liver function, like raised AST and ALT. So is that normal? Then cerebral symptoms like headache, visual disturbances, and sometimes there will be a pulmonary edema. So not necessarily the proteinuria is essential component of preeclampsia. Before we used to say there has to be proteinuria to say it's a preeclampsia, but nowadays they have downgraded the importance of the proteinuria, and if the other organs are involved, there, then also it is called as preeclampsia. The eclampsia is a condition where the patient is convulsion along with the raised blood pressure. So preeclampsia complicated by the convulsion is called as eclampsia. Then chronic hypertension, as we have already seen all these causes of chronic hypertension, secondary because of any kidney diseases or thyrotoxicosis or connective tissue disorder like a SLE, pheochromocytoma, coarctation of aorta. Then superimposed preeclampsia with a chronic hypertension, sometimes they are classified as chronic hypertension with preeclampsia and chronic hypertension with eclampsia if she gets convulsions. If you see the gestational hypertension, 50% of the patients of gestational hypertension, they progress to preeclampsia. Or sometimes they do not, 50% they do not progress to preeclampsia, but they will remain as a only raised blood pressure without any proteinuria or edema. And this is called as transient hypertension. And this blood pressure is regressed after delivery within 3 months. Why to classify this with the preeclampsia? Because the morbidity and mortality from mother and fetal point of view are less with gestational hypertension than the preeclampsia. So if we categorize those two conditions, we will come to know which patient has to be focused more or which are high risk patients. So if you see preeclampsia incidence is already we have discussed 5 to 10%, 10% you can say maximum in India, developing country, because of malnutrition, early age of marriage and repeated pregnancy, we get more incidence. So what are the predisposing factors? Like if she has a history of previous preeclampsia, again the recurrence of the preeclampsia in next subsequent pregnancy is also almost 30%. Especially when the preeclampsia has started prior 34 weeks, means early onset preeclampsia, the high chance of recurrence in next pregnancy, like almost 60% in case of early onset preeclampsia. And in late onset preeclampsia, it will be like 30%. Then what are the other causes? The immunological causes, sometimes a new partner, because of this immunological cause, she might get the preeclampsia. Then this vascular diseases, any vascular disease like essential hypertension or renal disease or family history of diabetes mellitus, any connective tissue disorders. If she gets a multiple pregnancy, twin pregnancy, triplet pregnancy, they are more likely that she will get the preeclampsia. When the pregnancy complicated by diabetes mellitus, or sometimes if it is a molar pregnancy, hereditary form mole or heterospitalis, all these leads to high chance of preeclampsia because there is a hyperplacentosis. There is a defect in or abnormality of the placenta, placental function, which leads to preeclampsia. So whenever there is an increase or not, we can say the cognac villi. If there is abundance of the cognac villi, the chances of the severity of hypertension is increasing. So in this condition we have high chance of preeclampsia. Then the other causes like obesity, then maternal age, in the extremes of the age group it is more common. The patient is obese or BMI is very high, then high chances of preeclampsia and hyperhomocysteinemia. So what is the etiopathogenesis? Basically it is shown in a chart like the diagram. So there is a faulty placentation as we have seen. Because of this, there are two trophoblastic waves. There is an abnormal invasion of the trophoblastic wave is responsible for the development of the ET. What happens? There is a these parallel arteries, they are invaded or invaginated by the trophoblast. So there will be a these parallel artery, they form like a lake or full of blood, and which are unresponsive to the pressure responses. So whenever there is an incomplete invasion of the trophoblast in the parallel arteries, there will be intact wall or intact endothelium of the spiral arteries, which are responsive for the pressure response by the pressure substances like thromboxane A2. If you see the or endothelin 1, interleukin, all these are the or oxidative stress, which is responsible for the vasospasm. So basically, if you see, because of endothelial activation, there will be a vasospasm and there will be capillary leak because of vasospasm. That next slide, we will see pathophysiology. What happens? two pathology are there, vasus spasm and vascular occlusion. Because of pressure responses of thromboxin and angiotensin 2, endothelin 2, there will be segmental vasoconstriction and segmental vasodilatation. So because of vasoconstriction, there will be reduction of the intramuscular volume. And sometimes there is a vasodilatation where there will be a capillary leak of the protein exudate, and there will be endothelial injury leading to edema. And there will be vascular occlusion, which leads to activation of the coagulation, and that leads to hypercoagulation and coagulation disorders. So this is the basic pathology of abnormal placentation along with the increased pressure response, vasospasm, vasoocclusion, and increased oxidative stress. There will be damage to the endothelium because of endothelin 1, and because of the release of thromboxane A2. Then what systemic changes it will give? If you see the cardiovascular changes, like there will be decreased intravascular compartment or volume, which leads to increased hemoconcentration, and it will be sensitive to volume loss. So when the patient has even minimal bleeding after delivery, because of this volume loss, will go into shock. So increased chance of postpartum hemorrhages. Then there will be hematological changes, like there will be decreased fibrinogen level, there will be low platelet count, there will be hemolysis and hemolytic anemia. Basic the pathology of this coagulation derangement is hemolysis, leading to increased bilirubin level or low platelet count, consumption of the platelet, and leading to DIC. Then morphological changes, like in the kidney, there will be a renal capillary endotheliosis, leading to acute tubular necrosis, which is reversible condition. But if she develops cortical necrosis, it will be a reversible condition. Then the liver, it will have caused a periportal thrombosis or hemorrhages and subcapsular hematoma, and leads to HELLP syndrome. There will be elevated liver enzymes, low platelet count, and hemolysis. Then in the retina, it will cause a papilledema and hemorrhages, water pool hemorrhages, and sometimes retinal detachment, which is also a reversible condition after treating the patient. So uteroplacental perfusion is also reduced. Then how will you predict the preeclampsia? What are the predicted tests for preeclampsia? It will be related to the tests which are related to pathophysiological changes. Because of pathophysiological changes, we can predict this PET at the cold pressure response. The isometric hand grip test, angiotensin test, and rollover test, and mean arterial pressure. What is the rollover test? In a physiological condition, in the second trimester, there will be drop of blood pressure, which will not be there in this. And there will be, if you keep the patient in the supine position, take a blood pressure, then ask her to roll on one side, and then again take blood pressure. If there is a rise of blood pressure of 20 millimeter of mercury in a supine position, means she has to be lying on lateral position, then she will be in supine position and take a blood pressure. So in supine position, there will be rise of blood pressure of 20 millimeter of mercury. It is called as positive rollover test. So in a mid trimester, it is usually done. Sometimes there is an absence of drop of blood pressure in mid trimester, also suggestive of development of preeclampsia, a prediction of preeclampsia. Then mean arterial pressure is some formula calculated, and when if you get a value of more than 105, it indicates development of preeclampsia. But if this has got, all this has got low positive predictive value. This mean arterial pressure is better predicting gestational hypertension than the preeclampsia. Then what is next is the uterine artery Doppler. If you see the diastolic notch on both sides in mid trimester, it indicates the development of preeclampsia. Then biochemical alterations because of renal dysfunction, like there will be a low urinary calcium and low urinary calcium to creatinine ratio of less than 0.03, normally is 0.44. Then if you see the uric acid and fibronectin level, the uric acid level will be more than 7.4. This is the early prediction of preeclampsia. And sometimes because of this endocrine dysfunction, we get deranged to the PAP-A, beta-ICG, inhibin, all this liver and estriol. All these liver are deranged. The same is written here. In the placental perfusion or vascular resistance or these pathophysiological changes which gives a this predictive test like Rollo test, then cold pressure, everything they are written in the same way. And in the renal dysfunction, they are given uric acid, then urinary calcium, this micro transferuria. Everything is same. And oxidative stress leads to low platelet count, fibronectin level, then SPAPA. So all this we have already discussed. Then what are the clinical features? As we see, this preeclampsia is a raised blood pressure along with the either proteinuria or any other organ dysfunction. So if she has a brain edema or cerebral edema, she will have a headache. Then visual disturbances because of effect on the retina. Then vomiting, drowsiness, epigastric pain or tenderness because of stretching of the liver capsule. So all these are the clinical features which indicate the severity of preeclampsia. Then how will you investigate the patient? In investigations, complete urine examination, see for the proteinuria, then presence of pus, and then culture sensitivity, the pus are significant. Then serum uric acid is more than 6 milligram percent, it's taken as abnormal. Then creatinine, the creatinine level more than 1.1 milligram per deciliter. The liver enzymes, the AST and ALT, if they are more than 70. Then LDH. LDH is a marker of hemolysis. If it is more than 600, it indicates significant value. Then because of this hemolysis, there will be abnormal peripheral smear. There will be an indirect hemoglobin level will be raised more than 1.2. And LDH will be more than 600. The coagulation test, the platelet counts, if they are less than 1 lakh, it indicates thrombocytopenia. Then there will be elevated prothrombin time and APTT also, and there will be decreased fibrinogen levels. As there may be a DI, patient may go into DIC, then you have to do the fundus examination. And so, that is for the baby's well being, like ultrasonography, the leaky APTT count, non stress test, and oxygen challenge if required, if it is not done commonly. But in the nutshell, you should know CBC, then including platelet, then urine routine microscopy, required culture, and then LFT and RFT, and coagulation profile. All these are mandatory for the investigations of preeclampsia. So, what are the clinical hallmarks? There is blood pressure. If you see, blood pressure, the rise of blood pressure of more than 30 systolic and 15 diastolic, it indicates preeclampsia. But nowadays this definition is also outdated now. They only just say the blood pressure more than 149 along with the proteinuria or other organ dysfunctions. There will be presence of edema will be present or may not be present. If she has she is developing coronary edema, she will complain dyspnea. And if there is a placental abruption or separation of placenta or coagulopathy, she will have bleeding. If there is a placental insufficiency, she will complain decreased fetal movements. We have to see for the fetal growth restriction also. Then how to categorize the preeclampsia? It will be a mild and severe. Previously, we used to say mild, moderate, severe. But now the moderate terminology has gone. Only mild and severe. So, mild preeclampsia, the blood pressure is more than 140-90 but less than 160-110. And in severe, it is more than 160-110. Then proteinuria will be there. There will be oliguria in case of severe preeclampsia, headache, visual disturbances, they will be present. Platelet count will be lower side, less than 1 lakh. Then the HELLP syndrome, complications of preeclampsia, they are more with the severe type in which we get this HELLP syndrome, maybe there. Leading to elevated liver enzymes, then there will be epigastric pain, there will be fetal growth restriction, and there will be pulmonary edema. All these are features, they are common in severe preeclampsia in the mild preeclampsia. Then what are the complications of preeclampsia? The complications, as we already discussed all the pathophysiology, the complications, they are depending on that, it may be maternal or fetal. In maternal, in case of CNS or central nervous system involvement, the patient may throw convulsions like eclampsia. There may be cerebral edema, cerebral hemorrhage, then cortical blindness, retinal detachment, which is reversible, of course. Patient may go into shock after convulsions. If she has a cerebral hemorrhage, she may develop hemiplegia. Then if it is a renal complications, it will lead to acute fibular necrosis, leading to reduced output. So, and then cortical necrosis may be there. She will need dialysis afterwards. Then in hematological complications, she will have developed disseminated intravascular coagulopathy or consumptive coagulopathy, in which there will be a low platelet count, elevated liver enzymes, and hemolysis. Then in respiratory system, we see the presence of pulmonary edema and adult respiratory distress syndrome. If it is liver complications, she will have a HELLP syndrome, as we already discussed, and hepatic rupture, which is not much common, but we will get subcapsular hematoma sometimes, then abruption of placenta, separation of placenta, then if it's a fetal complication, it will lead to prematurity, growth restriction, and long-term cardiovascular morbidity. So all these are the complications. Then the features of imminent eclampsia. How will you come to know that this pre-eclampsia is going to eclampsia state? That the patient's symptom is a patient with comparable headache, blurring of vision, epigastric pain, and oliguria. These are the four main symptoms: headache, blurring of vision, epigastric pain, and oliguria. And in signs, there will be persistent high blood pressure, papilledema, exaggerated reflexes, and pulmonary edema. And if you see the laboratory values, the creatinine is more than 1.1, uric acid more than 7.4, then AST, ALT will be doubled, platelet count will be less than 1 lakh. So how will you manage? There are various approaches. First, the prevention is the main important part. We prevent patient to progress into a severe preeclampsia, and treatment of severe preeclampsia, malignant preeclampsia, and eclampsia. So these are the various approaches for the management. For the prevention, the dietary manipulations like low salt diet. She should not take salty diet, which low salt diet. Then high protein diet, the diet which includes calcium, magnesium, zinc, supplementation has to be given. Then bed rest is also important part of prevention measure. At the left lateral, especially in left lateral position, she should lie down, because there will be improvement of the blood flow to the placenta. In a supine position, it will again reduce the blood flow to the placenta. So in a left lateral position, and we should advise her reduce physical activity. Then drugs like diuretics, they has to be avoided, but antihypertensive therapy we can start. Diuretics has to be avoided because there will be reduced placental flow. So usually we start with the antihypertensive drugs if the blood pressure is more than isolated 100. Then antioxidants like vitamin C, then vitamin E, vitamin D. Along with the antihypertensive, we can start with low-dose aspirin or low-dose aspirin with the heparin. Then along with how low-dose aspirin acts, it acts on a cyclooxygenase pathway. From arachidonic acid, we know that by cyclooxygenase pathway, there will be production of prostacyclin and thrombosin K2. Prostacyclin is a vasodilator and thrombosin K2 is a vasoconstrictor. So in low dose of this low dose aspirin, it will affect cyclooxygenase pathway. There will be reduced production of thrombosin A2, and there will be which is produced by the platelet, and there will be the production of prostacyclin will not be hampered. Prostacyclins are released at the wall of the vessels. So in smaller dose, it will reduce the release of thrombosin A2. Which is also constipated, that leads to vasodilation. So depending upon the severity of preeclampsia, we will treat the patient. If suppose this preeclampsia is mild, then there will not be any urgent need for a delivery. Actually, hospitalization is considered, but if it is mild, then you can defer the admission, and you can instruct the patient to do the regular blood pressure checking and taking antihypertensive drugs and warning about the signs and symptoms of severity of preeclampsia, and giving antihypertensive therapy. But sometimes we need to hospitalize the patient. Suppose in case of severe preeclampsia, we have to hospitalize the patient at 28 weeks of gestation only. Suppose she is a mild preeclampsia, you can admit after 34 weeks of gestation. So after admission, the principal treatment is to monitor her closely. Daily we have to take her blood pressure every 4 hourly. Then we have to see for proteinuria morning, evening by dish check, and see for the severity of proteinuria. Then we have to ask her to keep a daily fetal heat count. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we ask the patient to keep daily fetal heat count. We have to see the fetal movement and give her antihypertensive therapy. Give her adequate rest. Then we have to biweekly we have to do a non-stress test. Ultrasonography, if the Doppler is abnormal, we have to be weekly repeat the Doppler to see the placental flow. Then we have to see for the warning signs. And our aim is to achieve the fetal maturity. So we want to prolong the pregnancy up to 37 weeks of gestation. After that, we can terminate the pregnancy so that we will get a baby which is salvageable or in a good condition, and decrease in ICU stay, and the mother also in good condition. But the delivery is indicated even before that if she develops deteriorating signs of imminent eclampsia, or sometimes if she's heading for the helps, or if she develops a placental abruption, or sometimes if she develops a hepatorenal failure, then we need to think of termination of pregnancy even earlier than 37 weeks of gestation. So if you want to terminate the pregnancy earlier, then we can think of giving steroid for to increase the lung maturity. So how will you manage the patient in labor? The progress of labor is recorded with the help of partogram. Then we have to do continuous fetal monitoring. Then repeated abdominal imaging examination. Then when she is fully dilated, cut short the second stage of labor with the obtained forceps. In third stage, methandrin is contraindicated because we need to severe vasospasm. It is a sudden preload over the heart. So that is contraindicated. And otherwise, the principles of normal labor are applied. So if she has a previous severe preeclampsia, then our aim is to control her blood pressure by antihypertensive and prevent her from going to eclampsia state by using prophylactic Maxil. So in imminent preeclampsia and eclampsia, we are going to give magnesium sulfate as an anticonvulsant to her. The patient who are with severe preeclampsia and heading for eclampsia, and the patient of eclampsia. So, and we have to think of early delivery irrespective of the gestation. So what antihypertensive we use during pregnancy? There are three drugs, main drugs, important drugs we use in pregnancy as an antihypertensive, that calcium channel blocker like nifedipine, then labetalol and methylenedetol. So methyldopa is centrally acting, and the dose is 250 milligram twice a day, and this labetalol is a both alpha and beta adrenergic blocker. The dose is 100 milligram two times a day, and this nifedipine calcium channel blocker maximum 30 to 60 milligram per day. Adrenalizing is reserved for the restricted conditions where there is a severe hypertension and it has to be given IV, but other drugs we can give orally, which are more preferred. So if you see in the methyldopa, in after delivery usually we change methyldopa because it causes orthostatic hypertension, that is a side effect of this methyldopa, and depression. So after delivery usually we shift over to other hypertensive, we stop the methyldopa. And the labetalol should not be given in the heart disease and cardiac asthma cases. Then if you see the magnesium sulfate regime, we use two regimes. First is Pritchard's regime and second is Spahn regime. The Pritchard regime, we give a 14 gram loading dose to the patient with a 4 gram IV with a diluted 20% of the solution slowly over the 10 minutes, and 5 gram in each buttock, the total 14 gram, followed by 5 gram every 4 hours intramuscular dose, up to 24 hours after delivery or after last convulsion. In Zuspan regime, we give 4 gram IV followed by 1 gram per hour IV infusion. So both are equally effective, but the Kuchat regime is easy to give and requires less monitoring. The Kuchat regime. The standard regime is 14 gram loading dose with the Kuchat regime and followed by 5 gram every four hour. The alternate better. So in case of magnesium sulfate, I want to tell you. Before giving magnesium sulfate, we have to see for the 2-3 things before giving the next dose, because if you see the therapeutic level of magnesium sulfate is 4-7 milliequivalent per liter. If you process 8, then there will be more fetal this magnesium sulfate toxicity developing. The first will be there is absence of petalar reflex, and then if it crosses again 10, it will lead to even respiratory depression. So what thing you have to see before giving next dose is a urine output. You have to see it should be at least 120 ml per 4 hours, 30 ml per hour minimum. Then there should be a presence of petalar reflex, and there will be adequate respiration. So 3 things we have to see monitor before giving the magnesium sulfate. The antidote is, if you think of magnesium sulfate toxicity, the antidote is calcium gluconate. You have to give immediately. So this is a very good drug, magnesium sulfate. It acts as anticonvulsant also centrally and peripherally. It acts as a vasodilating agent, so it leads to reduced blood pressure. It's a wonderful drug. With the presence of this drug, the other regime, other like we previously used to study, like a cocktail regime, other regime, or this Dazepam regime, they have become outdated. In lytic cocktail, we used to give chlorpromazine and phenytoin also sometimes. So on this regime, they are now outdated. Nowadays, we only give magnesium sulfate. Then how to decide the timing of delivery? Then depending upon the severity of the disease, expected management till 37 weeks. If the there is unstable condition, then or if you have an imminent eclampsia, then you can think of terminating after 34 weeks. The mode of delivery is either we can go for vaginal delivery and cesarean section depending upon the condition of the baby and the mother. If the baby is salvageable, there is some fetal growth restriction, there is oligohydramnios, baby is salvageable, then it's better to deliver by cesarean section because we can give the baby in good condition. Or we can go for oxytocin challenge stress, see for the development of fetal distress. If she has fetal distress, then decide accordingly. If the baby is not salvageable, then we go for the vaginal delivery. Then eclampsia is a condition where there will be occurrence of convulsions. The eclampsia will be antepartum. 50% of cases we get antepartum eclampsia. Then 25% will be intrapartum and 25% postpartum. The clinical features like eclampsia means patient throws convulsion. What is a typical convulsion? Is a tonic-clonic convulsion. In that case, there is a prodromal phase of 30 seconds. There is aura. The patient can perceive the presence. She will go into convulsions. She will get some sensation for 30 seconds followed by the convulsive movements, which are tonic phase for 15 to 20 seconds. All the body becomes rigid, phase contracted, and there will be a starting of clonic phase, in which case they start from the facial muscles, involves the entire body, and there will be frothing at the mouth. Then there will be a recovery phase, there will be the convulsion subsides and respiration resumes again. Then the management depends when she is in a convulsion state, we have to take care of her airway. We have to put the airway, then turn on one side to prevent the tongue fall. And take care of her respiration. Then you have to take all the you have to take a blood for the all investigations like coagulation profile, liver function test, kidney function test, then arterial blood gas, then serum electrolytes, everything you have to take a blood. Then you put IV line and start with the magnesium sulfate. Also put a urinary catheter to see the 0 hour output. we have to keep her in a safe place where she there should not be any fall from the bed, and there should not be any trauma to her. Suppose it's a chronic hypertension, there will be a primary and secondary type of hypertension. Then etiology we have already discussed the complications, like same like the preeclampsia, eclampsia, then complications. Then the how will you manage the chronic hypertension? Then there should be conceptual evaluation. The blood pressure has to be controlled prior pregnancy. If she is on ACE inhibitor, they are contraindicated in pregnancy. So we have to change to this calcium channel blocker. Because the risk of peritoneal telangiectasia is more with this ACE inhibitor. Then you have to go for the fundoscopy and then LFT, RFT, ECG, all patients to evaluate the prior organ damage and find out the cause. If it is treatable, then you have to treat the cause. We are suspecting SLE, there's ANA test and has to be done to diagnose it. Then serum uric acid level, it will differentiate chronic hypertension from the preeclampsia. Then antidiuretics has to be stopped in an obstetric patient. When if she is already on hypertensive drugs, you have to continue the drugs. Otherwise, if there is a severe rise of blood pressure, like diastolic more than 100, then you need to start with the antihypertensive therapy. So antihypertensive drug has to be continued up to 40 weeks, and it has to be managed like a preeclampsia. The complications of 2-3 we will discuss, like health syndrome, AFLP, like they are complicating the preeclampsia. Health syndrome, H stands for hemolysis, E for elevated liver enzymes, L for low platelet counts. And the incidence is 0.5 to 0.9 of all pregnancies, and 10 to 20% of severe preeclampsia. The clinical features are 90% they present with generalized malaise, epigastric pain, nausea, vomiting, and headache. So, diagnostic criteria: hemolysis. There will be a raised blood bilirubin more than indirect bilirubin is raised more than 1.5. Then there will be a fall in hemoglobin level. Then there will be increased liver enzyme like AST, ALT will be more than 70, LDH more than 600, thrombocytopenia less than 1 lakh. Management, assessment, stabilization of the woman condition, fluid management, control of hypertension, prevention of seizure, platelet transfusion. Platelet transfusion, see, if you want to, our aim is to keep platelet at least 50,000. If you want to do some procedure like cesarean section, the platelet count has to be 50,000 minimum. And suppose she is having, she is going for normal delivery, then platelet count has to be 30,000. So otherwise, you have to transfuse the patient with the platelet. Maintenance is up to 50,000 at least. Then you have to keep the fresh frozen plasma, Paxil volume, and platelets, adequate platelets available to manage her. Then there is a dilemma of giving either steroid up in a postpartum period, because it will improve the platelet count, but it may lead to acute renal failure, pyelonephritis, eclampsia. So in case of severe thrombocytopenia or very, very low platelet count, then only we can think of giving steroid to the person to improve the platelet count. All these are the complications like abruptio placenta, BIC, retinal detachment, acute renal failure, pulmonary edema. If it's not treated in time, patient may critically ill, she may die. Acute fatal year of pregnancy, actually, it is not so much related to this. Is like the differential diagnosis of HELLPs, because if you are treating the HELLPs, we should know this condition also, in which case there is an abnormal liver function. It's a very deadly condition, AFLP, in which case the similar presentation, the patient presents nausea, malaise, vomiting, abdominal pain, but the difference is that she will have a jaundice. Icterus is a mark feature. She will have ascites and all signs of liver failure, and she will land up into hepatic encephalopathy. Then there will be a hypoglycemia, raised ALT, and hyperuricemia. Hypoglycemia and raised ammonia, these are the mark feature of AFLP that will differentiate between the HELLPs and the AFLP. then we have to go for the CT MRI to see for the evidence of that infiltration and our diagnosis by liver biopsy. All the other material is pulmonary hepatic failure, hepatic encephalopathy, coagulopathy, and death. Fetal risks are like fetal growth restriction, and there will be a transient derailment in LFT and hyperplasia. So this completes the topic of PIH. If you have any query,